thank you very much for the nice introduction. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, it is such an honor and a pleasure to be invited to speak at this Platts Top 250 Asia Award Ceremony in front of such distinguished energy executives. I would like to express my sincere appreciation to the organizer of this event for inviting me. My name is Keisuke Sadamori, and I'm the Director of Energy Markets and Security at the International Energy Agency in Paris. The top 250 energy companies to be awarded here today are navigating through the global energy map that is being redrawn by dynamic factors such as the shifting the center of gravity in energy demand towards the east of Suez region, unconventional energy revolution going on in North America, and higher penetration of renewable power sources being subsidized and increasingly competitive. With those fundamental changes in mind, let me walk through the recent developments in the oil, gas, and renewable markets with a special focus on Asia. First is the oil sector. In May, we released the medium-term oil market report 2013. In this report, we envisioned a more comfortable balance in the global oil market toward 2018 compared with the last few years. North American light tight oil and oil sands, as well as increased production from Iraq, would be the major contributor, while the reality of above-the-ground risk will limit the OPEC supply growth. Only 5 months have passed since the release of this medium-term oil market report, but we are already seeing more oil than forecasted coming from the non-OPEC countries. In the most recent oil market report in October, we added 360 KBD to our growth forecast for 2014 to 1.72 million barrels per day. Most comes from North American light tight oil and natural gas liquids, but former Soviet Union countries also contribute. Demand will further shift east. From 2012 to 2018, non-OECD demand will grow by 8.4 million barrels per day, while the OECD demand contracts decrease by 1.5 million barrels per day due to the efficiency gains and slow economic growth. And China will continue to play a leading role with a bit subdued 3.7% per year as their economy moves to a less energy-intensive stage of development. India and ASEAN will follow. The IEA recently released the World Energy Outlook, the WEO Southeast Asia Energy Outlook. And my colleague, Fatih Birol, presented its findings on Monday here at the Singapore International Energy Week. The WEO ASEAN report foresees that ASEAN region's oil import will increase from 1.9 million barrels per day today to over 5 million barrels per day in 2035, the fourth largest region behind China, India, and Europe. These changes in supply and demand comes down to the familiar picture of the global crude trade map split between the very busy traffic in the east on the right-hand side and very quiet trade over the Atlantic on the left. It is not only demand and supply that will go through drastic changes, but also the refining sector. The growth in refining capacity in the Middle East, China, and India, and others, are expected to be even faster than their demand growth, implying longer haul product trade and possible harsh competition in the product export market. Turning to the Western Hemisphere, North American refineries and the petrochemical sectors are likely to enjoy a huge advantage of access to the cheap feedstock, and gas energy sources. These changes will surely lead to a more difficult business environment for the European refineries already suffering from a shrinking European market. Now let me turn to gas, in particular the LNG. The World Energy Outlook by the IEA used the term golden age of gas in 2011. But are we really in the golden age? It depends on who you ask. If you ask this question to the European gas industries and utilities, their feeling must be mostly far from that. In Europe, gas power generation is squeezed between the renewables and the cheaper coal. In fact, last year, in 2012, the global LNG trade decreased by 2%, in spite of the strong growth in Asia, increasing by 8%. So this pushed up the share of the Asian LNG imports in the global LNG trade to 70%. So in a sense, we can even say that it was the decrease in gas demand in Europe that supplied the growing Asian gas market. And here again, when we draw the global LNG trading map, it is just like oil, split to busy traffic in the east and quiet trade in the west. And you can find it in the medium-term gas market report that we released in June. Now, going forward, the Asian gas demand will increase toward the 2018, according to a medium-term market report, from 664 BCM to 915 BCM. Among them, Chinese demand will double from around 150 BCM in 2012 to nearly 300 BCM. In 2018. And China has pipeline options as well as increasing domestic production, but for most Asian countries, LNG imports are the key. However, the global LNG capacity will have limited additions in the coming few years, and we expect a tight LNG market ahead. In addition, new LNG projects have already been contracted to Asian buyers on a long-term basis. One notable and worrying development about this Asian LNG trade is the increased price disparity among the regions of the world. Natural gas has never had a global market, actually. Nevertheless, in the past decade, a convergence took place, and by 2009, there seems to have been something like a global price of gas. Between Asia, Europe, and North America with less than a 10% difference from each other. But then, the last 3 years witnessed an amazing disconnect. The shale revolution crashed the North American gas prices at exactly the same time that as the persistent oil indexation drove them to a record level in Asia. And this is a massive competitiveness burden on the Asian economies and will jeopardize the potential energy security and sustainability contribution of gas. Europe is in a similar situation, but has seen much lower prices than Asia because competition has started to work there. Again, according to the WEO Southeast Asian Energy Outlook, the ASEAN's generation, electricity generation mix will see a drastic change. The coal-fired power generation, which currently generates 217 terawatt hour, and that is about 30% of the entire generation in 2011, will grow to 439 terawatt hour in 2020, and 914 terawatt hour in 2035. And that would amount to an increase of 6% growth per year and will take about half of the entire generation in 2035. On the other hand, gas-fired power generation will increase modestly by 2.2% annually, losing its share from 44% in 2011 to 28% in 2035. And I also need to add that 70% of coal-fired power plants under construction in this region of ASEAN are of subcritical type with low efficiency. And this is coming from economics and understandable, but gas is the least carbon intensive among the fossil fuels. So we should try to seek such benefits as much as we can. And that is why the IEA released a report, Developing an LNG Trading Hub in Asia in February this year. It was also meant to contribute to the LNG Producer-Consumer Conference in Tokyo. This year, it was on 10th of September. And this report points out the need for gas and electricity market reforms in countries such as Japan, Korea, and China, and raises systemic and institutional issues related to the development of LNG trading hubs, and state that Singapore can be the best candidate for such a trading hub in the near future. Also, we need new competitive suppliers in this region. And of course, North American LNG is expected to play a crucial role. But new entrants from the East, Russia, Central Asia, and in the longer term, the East Africa, are welcome to bring about more competition. And it would take time, but we have to do our best to bring about the competitive market and pricing for gas trade in this region. So that's about the gas. And finally, let me discuss renewable sources very briefly. As shown in the medium-term renewable energy market report, the growth in renewable electricity, solar PV and wind onshore wind in particular, will be robust in the coming years. Renewable electricity growth is currently on track of the 2 degrees Celsius scenario by the energy technology perspective of the IEA. And this strong growth in renewable deployment is connected to the significant cost reduction in PV and wind technologies in both ways. So renewable sources are becoming cost competitive in a broader area and broader range of situations. In the area of the rooftop residential PV, we are finally starting to see what is called the grid parity. This grid parity is when the generation cost by the rooftop solar PV is equal to the variable elements of the electricity tariff. So that's congratulations, and this is a good news for the renewable deployment and the climate change mitigation. On the other hand, however, the higher penetration of those renewable sources, together with the more liberalized electricity market, is presenting a new set of challenges for the electricity systems. One of the concerns is over generation adequacy, how we can secure needed investment for generation capacity that can provide flexibility to support the variable renewable grid integration. Network investment in both transmission and distribution are also of concern. The role of transmission and distribution is no longer simple delivery of electricity from big generators to the end users. Transmission grid management requires a more precise and timely situation awareness and bottleneck management. Distribution is another issue. The increasing volume of distributed generation is presenting a totally new situation for grid management. The flow in the distribution network used to be simply from transmission to the end users. Now, we are seeing a more complicated flow from the other end of the networks. And this is not only about the technical problem of more complicated electricity flow. With more distributed generation source producing electricity while at the same time enjoying the benefit of being connected to the grid, utilities will find it harder to collect the revenue corresponding to the fixed cost for maintaining the grid. And this would also lead to the discussion as to how the generated electricity from the renewable generations should be remunerated. So that's about the renewables. And so I quickly looked at the recent developments and policy issues in oil, gas, renewable, and electricity. And I would have to say that the changes are rapid and challenges are enormous. And it is the energy industries that actually develop, produce, and deliver energy to users in order to let the economies move on. Innovations by those energy industries, including the 250 companies awarded today, are critical to achieve secure, affordable, and sustainable future energy systems. And the IEA will continue to work with member and non-member countries to explore the best policy framework to make that happen. Thank you very much for your attention. Thank you.